Just the ambush them.
Hmm.
So you're not rotating, you're just tuning it. So I think you want to keep to as little movement as possible.
Yeah. Do you want to go with either one or another? You can check that you can hear things.
That is what?
Yeah, get it on mind.
If you have a look at your notifications, it should say we've gone live. This is 18 minutes. Hello, 18 people watching. You probably can.
Is that live now, Robin?
Yeah.
On the council of Facebook?
Yeah, we're just trying to. You got audio? You can hear?
Thank you.
We'll start the meeting. This is a little bit different than anything we've done before, because the world is in a different space than we've ever been in. But thank you for making yourselves available and coming today or joining us from your homes. I'm going to read through the council affirmation and the karakia, and then we'll kick into our meeting. So let us affirm today that we as councillors will work together to serve the citizens of Selwyn District. To always use our gifts of understanding, courage, common sense, wisdom and integrity in all our discussions, dealings and decisions so that we may solve problems effectively. May we always recognise each other's values and opinions, be fair-minded and ready to listen to each other's point of view. In our dealings with each other, let us always be open to the truth of others and ready to seek agreement, slow to take offence and always prepared to forgive. May we always work to enhance the well-being of Selwyn District and its communities. And the karakia, whakataka te hau ki te uru, whakataka te hau ki te utonga, kia mākina kina kūrutara, kia mātaratara ki tai, e hi a kia nā te atapura, e hi au, e huka, e haugu, ti hei mauri ora. As we look at starting the meeting, I'll just also acknowledge that this is the first meeting we've had live streamed and currently on Council's Facebook. For those that have been unable to come into the meeting today or able to view what's going on, they can see the room, but they can't see you at home and they can't see what's going on the computers. But if you're at home, just know that Robin's at the front of the room with a camera that's a fly on the wall. And we're also, Jonathan Lester's joined us. Jonathan, thank you for coming in and reporting on the meeting today. The way that we will run through our reports is that staff are not going to be present here other than David. He's been briefed on all the matters that are here. If there are questions that require any specific detail, we'll hold over answers to a future time. Certainly, if there's any apologies for the meeting, and we get to have six of us in the room to call the meeting to order, and then we just everyone that's at home is also able to vote during this meeting, so it constitutes a full meeting of council. As far as identification of each ordinary, the CDFB won't be happening. We didn't think it was good to bring it back here today, and from the time when we organised this 7 days ago, lots has changed, and we now only hear us away from level four.
Sam?
Yes, Mark?
Just for accuracy, will we be recording in the minutes those who were physically present versus those who were remotely present? So, just in case there are any questions. This is our first meeting, but as we move further down the track, and perhaps more are not physically present, probably important to record who was and who wasn't.
Yep, it can be recorded. It's not, everyone is still a full member, but it's good to know that, Mark, because it only constitutes a meeting if we had the number of present that we do. LGNZ is currently working with government to try and amend the rules around the LGA to ensure that we have to get all of our meetings online from now on, and we don't have to have anyone in a room to make this happen. So hopefully that by the time we have the meetings time, none of us will be in this room, and we'll all be in our own offices or living rooms or walking down the park, or we end up doing it in a few days' time. Are there any conflicts of interest that aren't already on the register of interest? None. And there's no public forum happening today. Mr. Jarvie has been corresponded with, and Andrew Boyd has contacted him around recycling bin options. That may be something that comes up in the future, but at the moment it's taken care of. We have the minutes of ordinary meeting of Selwyn District Council held in council chambers on Wednesday the 11th of March. Can someone confirm that we move those? It's Councillor Alexander and Councillor Heston. Is there any discussion on those minutes? And if you're at home and want to discuss something, you can just put your hand up and I can see two of you, and if you want to speak or move something, great. Moved and seconded. All those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
Against? Carried. And you're voting at home too, you can raise your hand as a vote if you want to be included on that. Current matters requiring attention to Aotea is due on the 25th of March. I suggest that it's unlikely to be reported then, but we'll just see how the next couple of weeks unfolds. And similarly with the 8th of April, implementation of district-wide rates is unlikely, I think, to be reported on the We'll move now to the Chief Executive's report, and it's on page 23 through 28.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and good morning, everybody. So the first item is on COVID response. Now, do you want me to deal with that in detail now?
Yeah.
Or to do it at the end?
We'll do a separate item at the end.
Let's go. So take those items. Item number one, item number two for information, noting on page 25 of the paper copy that's tabled there of closed public meetings. Those, of course, are now not happening. And it's just a change in delegation requirements, Mr. Chair. Happy to answer any questions, though.
Are there any questions of the report, Councillor Levin?
Yeah, thanks, David. Coastal Hazards, obviously, we can't do those public meetings. Get in a couple of inquiries that haven't brought themselves still waiting to the respondent. The question.
Sorry, Mark, just speaking to your microphone. I'm sorry to hear about
it. Yeah, beg your pardon. I've had a couple of people contact me and wonder what the process will be. I said it's too early for that process to be announced, but there will be some method of consultation. So if you can confirm that for us.
Yes, I can confirm that, and certainly the same space, Murray, for annual plan consultation as well, for the same reasons. The big problem I've got at the moment, of course, is that whilst we want to deliver information to people, the difference is adopted. So, let's see what
we can do. Michael, are you able to turn up the sound of the room just so the microphones come through louder so that those in our home can hear? Can you turn the main volume for the room up?
I have the publication and the advice we've received around the community about the flooding has caused much confusion as well. As we've done our best to explain what it means, it has created a lot of anxiety in the community. Suddenly people find their properties are going to be listed as a flood hazard on their limbs, and there's much concern about what the implication of that is for insurance and things. So while we cannot have these meetings, it would still be helpful if we were able to respond further publicly via the council website, possibly social media, with respect to those implications. I've been assuring as many as I can that really it's little or no implication, because for most, there's a dot or two on the property, they're not able to or planning to do it there, so there's no implication. But that message is not well understood in the community, and it's not X. So if we could further highlight the ramifications, that they're relatively small, and if for most people nothing to worry about, that would be helpful in the community.
Thanks, Mark. Grant?
Yeah, I guess I might take the slightly different view. Are the ramifications small as Mark describes, or is this a sea change by our rate payers? Because floating maps, insurance companies are inherently very interested in them, and I would suggest we need to do a bit of more investigation as to what it might mean for our rate payers before we dismiss it as minor, because if you look at the flood maps from what they are now to what was previously, it's a very large scale change. And I think a more prudent approach might be to give our rate payers some assurance that the implication is not as huge as we think they may be.
I think that the response from the insurance companies is going to be determined by a number of things, and this is one piece of information that makes a difference. I'm not quite sure what you're asking for as far as change goes. I think that it's good that the information has been put out to people. We're unable to now hold public meetings for sort of question and answers and to let people know in any more detail what's going on with them. But I hope that will still continue once we get out of this phase, because there's going to be a lot of answers, or a lot of questions that people do need answers to, and that's best done in a one-on-one type situation. But I don't think that can happen in the next 4 weeks, and that's definitely going to be after that. So my assumption is through this that there will be the plan will be hit of public consultation will still continue, and obviously this is part of the district plan and will be rolled up in any consultation that goes on with that. David, do you have anything you'd like to
say? Just to be clear, Sam, what I was saying is I don't think it's a good idea for Mark to go around saying that the effects will be minor when they may not be minor. Is that not fair? It's not people may take that as a council position.
No, to be clear, I've said that to the people when we examined their property on the map, and they had one or two yellow dots, which is less than 0.2 of a metre, in a corner of the section on which they cannot build. I haven't said it in general, it's been specific instances where that is the assurance I've had from staff that in those cases there is quite a potential, but it is minor.
I think we just need to remember too that we are council, that we're not experts in flooding or insurance or builders, and we just need to let those people who are experts in those fields give the advice when it's sought. What we can provide advice on is effects around building heights and things related to our district plan, and as a council, I think it's appropriate that we talk about those things which are in our control rather than conjecture that may prove right or wrong depending on where the experts land on it. Deborah?
Thank you, Sam. Look, I've actually asked the sort of planning team with regards to, I think it's LIDAR mapping, is that the blue maps that we actually have?
LIDAR
mapping. Whether our mapping for planning actually has a correlation with regards to our LIDAR mapping. Because the LIDAR mapping actually shows all the underrunners, the low spots, channels, etc. It's just on people's properties, and it's pretty accurate. And people know that if they're in a rural property, they're the areas that fill out the water first, and they are clearly shown on that mapping. And I just asked the planning whether they used that mapping mechanism to assist with their mapping mechanism and understanding what the effects are.
You can follow that up with planning. It's an answer that can be answered, but to my knowledge, yes, an all information was used by money to get ourselves to come to the answers that we've got now. Someone happy that we received the Tuesday evening's report? Move Councillor Lyon and seconded. Thank you, Councillor. Sorry, Jeff, you as well. All those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
Against, there are carried. Adoption of supporting information for the Council's annual plan consultation document, pages 29 through 153.
So in speaking to this item, we are mindful that the things that we know today will be entirely different from the things that we know when we come to the deliberation. We know that there is a proposed variation to our rates and charges, and they are there for various reasons. There are some drivers, or those the principal ones are CPI, project-related costs, and OPEX costs for a number of those projects, and also staff that we need to meet continued growth in our district. So what do we know for certain? We know for certain that staffing level requirements will change in the future from what our currently prepared, and that will be what our currently proposed to us, saying that will depend on variation to levels of service, that will depend on how we respond to the requirements of the community when we get through the lockdown period. Whatever that might be in terms of the time, we also know that there are considerable staffing costs within the proposed budget relating to the operation of a number of new projects. We know that there are costs, both CapEx, predominantly CapEx, and debt related associated with the advanced construction of a number of these projects, which will probably not take place. Also, for some of the infrastructure projects that we are proposing to undertake. We know that we will be suffering loss of revenue, not only from the operation of our facilities, but also consenting and possibly the income coming through. Flip side of that, of course, is that we know that we will not be incurring none of OPEX costs for our facilities through the close down period. I've got two of my finance team who are dedicated to preparing models at the moment. That's very, very fluid in terms of where we are on a daily basis, because today we go into a 4-week lockdown. We don't know what's going to happen at the end of that 4 weeks. Will it be extended? Will we come back to level 3 or level 2? And will life be different? My advice to you today is to adopt the material as it is for consultation. The Mayor has yesterday, I think, circulated to everybody a letter that's going to put in front of all information that we're putting out to say, hey, listen, these are uncertain times. Flexibility, what is the right level of revenue required for council? And right at this moment, we do not know what that is going to be, and we'll know what that is going to be. The other thing that we have uncertainty about is the way that we will consult. At the moment, we can't even print consultation documents because, of course, the printers are in lockdown. I don't know what will happen to that in 4 weeks' time. One of the scenarios that we're currently looking at is if the lockdown continues, we will simply put leaflet drop information into people's letterboxes as best we are able and point them to the electronic, our website and the electronic signatures processes. And yes, I know not everybody has access to that, but we will do the best that we can. Final comments here is that we have advice from LGNZ that the National Committee are considering measures specific to councils that include what to do with our annual plans at this time in terms of the consultation and the content of the variation. So, Mr. Mayor, happy to answer any questions, but my advice would be to council to adopt what it is that we have on the agenda today, acknowledging the need for flexibility, and when we come to a deliberation, it will be paramount that council's request from staff varying options around the financial impact of both revenue size and the ongoing OPEX size.
Thank you, David. The lunch that I circulated to councillors and the feedback that was received on that, I just want to read it now because it provides the context I think that's about where are we going and the flexibility that we need to have when it comes to either receiving the submissions or making a determination at some point in time. At our best guess at what 2021 is going to look like, because we're not going to have full information when it comes to even in June to know what the following year is going to be, but we're still going to have to set what rates will be there, what services will be provided, what facilities
are going to be open, and yes, in the best case that we can make under the circumstances. So the letter that's going to accompany the information that goes out, and I do support it being sent out because it was the best information that we had at the time. It was for the last 6 months pulling it together, and it was pretty much all ready to go. But kia ora koutou, Selwyn, will be at the beginning. As a community, we are doing an amazing job to combat COVID-19. I know it's been a difficult few weeks, and pain is not over, but we will get through this together. We're experiencing disruption and inconvenience on a scale not seen in our community, but we're also seeing compassion and kindness shown to those in our homes through this time of isolation. The annual plan document is the product of the last 6 months' work, and I'm writing this as we enter full lockdown at alert level 4. The world is changing dramatically, and we're living with heightened uncertainty. In light of our situation, many of the projects and services planned in this document will now prove to be unnecessary. There will be many projects that were previously obvious to complete that will now not progress. Conversely, there were many things that we haven't given priority to that will now be the focus of the next 12 months. The annual plan has been sent to all households and so on. Some like reading while you're at home. Have a read and think about what you value continuing and concluding. We invite new ideas and new thinking. The consultation process gives you the opportunity to prepare a submission in which you can tell us what you like in our annual plan and the things you suggest that we might do differently. The plans the council has put in place are for the long term, but to meet immediate demand. As you form a submission, I ask that you consider how you see Selwyn developing over the next 30 years, but with immediate focus on 2020-2021. In early 2021, we will commence community involvement in a more structured plan for the next 10 years, and this is when all your good long-term thinking will have a chance to shine. The reason for the proposed rating level changes continue to evolve. This includes facilities being closed, means there's lower levels of revenue and lower operational costs. Projects being delayed means that a lower debt cost than originally forecast. Work must continue with water and wastewater renewables, as well as many other essential infrastructure investments. There are overhead costs which will remain, although as projects change, the staff associated with those projects will also be reviewed. We do not yet know how we will assess submissions or in what form hearings will take, as in-person may not be appropriate. We will communicate how this will function towards the end of April. Council must approve the final document prior to the end of June. In the meantime, take care and look after yourself and your family. Kia kaha, aroha nui, Sam and David signed off. So I'll move that we, Council adopts the draft annual plan 2020-2021 and the supporting information for the annual plan consultation document. Councillor Lyle, is there any discussion on it? There being none, all those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Against? Declare it carried. Item number 3 is the annual plan consultation document. It's on pages 154 through 187. That the council adopts the annual plan consultation document, including proposed amendments to the development contributions policy for public consultation. Is there a mover? Thank you, Councillor Lemon. And Councillor McInnes. Is there any discussion on that?
Yes.
I guess Councillor Alexander. And yeah. Mark, can I just get you to turn your microphone on? Sorry, for those in the room, you will turn the mic on our devices because those people at home are just having a little bit of trouble hearing what's being said in the room.
Okay. It is with great reluctance that I'm not going to support this consultation document. As I said when we workshopped this document, I support all but 8 words in this document. If you turn to page 10, of the consultation document, which is actually page 171 in our agenda. In the middle column, it talks about how the Dafi wastewater system capital costs might be funded. At the bottom of the middle column, it says for existing property owners, contributions from future land developers, and rates paid by the wider Selwyn district. Those final 8 words that I do not support, it gives a false hope to those potential people who might have to be paying for the capital costs of a Darfield wastewater system, that the district, the other ratepayers across the district, would be rated to help pay those capital costs. We have never done that in Selwyn before. The Darfield ratepayers were not asked to pay the capital costs of sewer in any other township in this district. We have not said that to the people of the Upper Selwyn Huts, that
we would fund the sewer upgrade across the wider district. In fact, we specifically said to them, you have to pay for this. I don't believe I would have enough support for an amendment to remove those words. So I would be voting against the adoption of this consultation document because I believe these words provide a false hope to these residents and ratepayers and do not correctly indicate the current practice of this council.
Thanks, Mark. Deborah? Can you turn your microphone on, Deborah?
Microphone on.
On your device also.
Oh, sorry. Can you hear me now? To agree with Councillor Alexander. I remember when we actually put our consultation document with regards to solar huts and it was left ambiguous, and they came along and thought that under district wide rating that their cost, their costs were going to be picked up by everybody under district wide rating, and that was not correct. And it needs to be a lot clearer in the consultation document so there's no ambiguity of people fronting up and saying that you produced a consultation document, you said it would be paid by the district-wide rate and capital costs. Doesn't mention capital costs in there. I admit that if you're going to say the capital costs will be paid by the individual ratepayers, the operating costs, operating costs will be paid by the district-wide rating, then that makes it quite clear to them that they are going to be up for some capital cost charges. But maybe all of those costs, you can come along later and you can maybe sort it out. But I think it needs to be quite clear that the capital costs of the networks will actually be a rate payer funded. You know, from Darfield would actually be need to be paid the same as the developers are paying for their contributions into the land. Thank you.
Thanks, Deborah. And if you just turn your microphone off on your device. And next you have Murray. Murray, can you turn your microphone off?
Yeah, thanks, Sam. Look, I'm happy to continue with that in the form that it is because I believe we will get feedback. I know a large number of constituents from my ward will submit and say that, as the discussion's been here, that is the case. But I think it's appropriate that we have that in here to get the actual views. That may have been what we did in the past, and it may be what we do in the present. So I think it's incumbent on us to consult on that and ensure that we do get those views expressed. And I fully expect the very views that Councillor Hassan and Alexander, if it's to do, is predetermine my response to the funding list. I want to ensure that we have a proper discussion at this table when we come to deliberate, and these views can be brought to the fore then. But I don't wish to predetermine that outcome from my perspective. Thank you.
I agree with Councillor just because we haven't done it this way in the past, consider it in the future. This is 2020. We've got a much bigger population now. It potentially, if it does end up going to district-wide rates, then there's a lot more people to spread that across. And it also comes down to a bit of human rights as well, to be honest. Darfield is one of the largest towns in South Island, at least, that doesn't have its own wastewater system. Councillor Mumford and Councillor Gallagher obviously know that it's taken a long time to even get to this point for it to be an annual grant. So, ruling out potential, the possibilities for how to fund this for a large population, which workers, without letting everybody else have their say, would be wrong. So I say keep it in mind.
Well, I agree with Mark and Deborah. I think we definitely need to separate CapEx and operational costs. That is the issue. The way in which we funded sewage in the past is that individual communities have suffered with a large amount of money at the time to do so. My community, I know, will not be happy to think that they were subsidised. Another community, when they had to pay a lot of money to get their sewage scheme in at the time, I find it untenable that we are looking at going that way, and I support the change to the wording. It's all we want, is a change to the wording, and people can still have the same debate with the wording change to say that they think they should be funded, and I'm sure that we will get that from that area of the Melbourne community, because they usually are not shy in coming forward and telling us what they want. So I support, if this hasn't been printed yet, I support a change to the wording as suggested by Councillor Hassan, where we talk about separating CapEx and OpEx within that phrase that we have in the plan. Thank you.
I've got a suggestion that we actually retain the wording, but we realign up. So if you have a look at column 2, it starts off by saying there are a range of funding options pay for the initial construction of the scheme, including, and then put the 1, 2, 3, 4 bullet points, because that's factually correct, that's the 360. And that goes on and says the funding will depend on a number of factors, including etc. Then we get to the comment on operating costs, and it comes back to Murray's comment that what are the options available to the community, have we exposed those fully, then we'll get responses back through the submission. So my suggestion, retain the wording, but just change the order of it.
Then we've got Councillor Bland and Councillor Knight.
As a councillor, we shouldn't really be swapping what's happened in the past. What's happened in the past is usually a pretty good wayfinder for what we should be doing in the future. Just because we've built this format doesn't mean to say that we should change what's happened in the past. I actually agree with the previous speakers, Mr. Alexander, Heston, and Lyle. I think that any document that you send out should be have complete clarity and not rely on what other people say. I understand that we should have an open view. If in the future it becomes overwhelmingly from all sectors of Selwyn that they want the district-wide rate to cover this type of CapEx and things like that, well, then you should listen. At this stage, you should be giving people the thoughts that that's what we're considering, because we're not considering it at the moment.
And Grant, if you can unmute your head, say Grant, please.
I think it's a great way of getting that horse so far in front of the cart, it's probably forgotten what the cart is. This is a discussion document. It's incredible that we're in the damn trade words. It's, we're really, what we're telling our community is, these are the options, and this doesn't include all the options. We're talking about a three waters review. There may be central government options, there may be left field options that come out of it. All it's telling our communities that these are the options on the table potentially, but there are others as well. Well, let's get a grip here. Guys, this is just a discussion document. Let's move on.
Yeah, well, see. I agree with what Councillor Miller has just said. We don't even know the complexity of the project to know which pieces could be funded different ways yet, and so to discount any of them at this point, I think that is premature. I like the CEO said around the rechange of the wording though, because that does clarify that what we're talking about is there are multiple options and then list what those options are, rather than having what almost seems like some definitive answers at the bottom. I've got two speakers at home who would like to talk, and I'll give Councillor Mackford and then Councillor Reid. So with the rearranged words, we've delved very deeply into one item that's in the consultation document, but with the rearranged words that just provide clarity around what the funding options are for Dafu and Wastewater, we moved by the amount that's either one. Can I ask you, happy that those changes be made as suggested by CEO?
Yes.
Yeah. All those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
Against?
No.
They're carried.
And I'd like my vote recorded, please.
Councillor Alexander would like his vote recorded against. Done. The next item is item number four. It's Rolleston Community Centre Future Use Proposal, which is actually the item that I said at the very beginning, some matters arising, so it's been dealt with on today's agenda.
Speaking very briefly, Mr. Mayor and Councillors, to this item. Can recommendations, recommendation five, where we consult with the community on future use, etc., as part of the 21 to 31 long term plan response. Given the status of where we are at the moment with our lockdown, given the proposals that we've got with respect to Rolleston Town Centre and associated projects, I don't think it's clear we have any option but to follow that order.
Thank you, Councillor Alexander.
Thank you. I have been asked by a number of Rolleston residents if this item could be left on the table because they would have liked to have come here and addressed council at the public forum about items in this report, but have been unable to. The chief executive is correct that it's the main thrust as this will be consulted on the next year's long-term plan, but they have issues with some of the content of this report and appreciate an opportunity to address council before that is adopted. I'm not going to move now that this report lie on the table because I'm interested to hear the feedback from other councillors, but that is what I have been requested to do. Because of it's aimed at consultation for next year's annual plan, there isn't an urgency to adopt this. Next year's long term plan, there is an emergency to adopt this today. It could lie on the table for a month, 6 or 8 weeks, and be adopted once people have had a chance to come and address us on items in it. We'd not lose anything by doing that, we'd in fact increase because we'd be seen to be more democratic, open, and transparent.
Councillor Atkinson? Just turn your microphone on, Mr. Chair.
No. Just with regards to this document, I'm going to actually agree with Mark that because of the uncertainty and I'm a little bit unsure about how we're going to actually manage our funding going forward. And there's quite a few reports in this agenda now because things have changed so much that I just wonder if we are going to be smart enough and it's advisable that we actually leave some of these to lie on the table until we have greater clarity around our economic situation and reporting back.
Well, to take Grant's words before, for the cart before the horse, we've just had this very same conversation in the last item we discussed. This is going out for consultation basically in a long term plan next year with the public with adequate time to make the points they want to make and to be consulted. I think it should go through as it seems.
Thank you, Councillor Gillis.
I was going to say actually the same as Nathan, that Grant's words from before said this quite well. I definitely agree with Councillor Alexander that the committee needs more input into this. However, we're actually, we're talking right now about accepting a report. That doesn't mean we have to go along with the proposals in the report. I know several people who would also like to speak either in public forum or submissions or something regarding this particular issue, but we're not talking about doing it now, and the long-term plan process is still quite some distance away. Reacting right now on something that's quite going to be quite a large, expensive project, that's just getting too far at this time. We've got bigger things to deal with right now. It's just a report, a consultation plan to make up.
Councillor
Reid and Mugford. If you would like to speak as well, there's a little option on your screen that says raise hand, and if you click that, it puts a little blue hand in the top of your screen, which means that we can see if you want to speak. You're also welcome just to wave your hand at me at any time, and I'll try and catch that, but there's a little, just so you know, there's a raise hand option that's there. Councillor Reid, would you like to add to the discussion today? I think that we've got adequate time for the community to have a look into this. By sharing it with the community now, it's already a public document on our agenda today. And if we share it with them, that gives them a sense of where the discussion to this point have come to. It points to a certain direction, and that will actually add. Starting from blank slate again, and if we were to put this on the table, and I think that's doing service to our community, it's better to share the information that we have. All people with all the caveats that we know we're going through at the moment, that things aren't going to change. So I'm quite happy to move that one through five that's here.
seconded by Councillor Lemon. Is there any further discussion? All those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
Against? Declare it carries. Item number five is Selwyn Hut's licence and charges fee review.
So, every month we read the reports and you will see that this is going to be part of the stage increase to the licence fees. The licence fees are currently $582. If you go to page 235 of the written report, you'll see they are going to increase, albeit to what we will depend on under wastewater solution. My recommendation, and this report, staff recommendation on this report, is that we increase to 977. That has been discussed with the group down at the Huts, and if they have an objection to that, they'll come back through all the processes. Mr. Mayor spoke to indicate that the level of concern, but they do understand the increase.
I'll move.
Thank you, Councillor. Move, Councillor. It's been moved by Councillor Lyle and seconded by Councillor Bland. Any further discussion? Councillor Bland, do you want to?
No, I'm
Bob. Bob, got something you want to discuss? No. All those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
Against? Declare it carries. Item number six.
The recommendation requires approval to circulate to the hut owners the revised draft deed of licence. We know that the current licence expires at the 30th of June. There's been a lot of effort behind the scenes put into this in terms of not only staff involvement, professional advice, and also discussions with the local community. And the key is to undertake the deed to the hut owners and present to council the final deed.
It's been moved by Councillor Lyle. Is there a seconder for the report? Councillor Mathers. Both this report and the one before speak to the long-term viability and sustainability of the huts, as well as the solutions Council's trying to put in place around wastewater and deals that we have in the community. That is a finite term. Very reliant on resource consents and those visitors can share clearly with that community. I've got Councillor Alexander and Councillor Hassan.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The query I have is, given the imminent stage of lockdown, is the consultation timeframes in this recommendation that they have to respond by the 14th of May and be adopted by the 27th of May. I'm wondering whether we have some more flexibility in that to either extend the resolution today or acknowledge that these may be timeframes that in the current circumstances are difficult to meet. I'd hate for us to be accused by some hut owner patch who isn't resident but has some other email address, physical mail address, that we didn't consult due to this lockdown. So whether we have the flexibility to change those time, either today or just acknowledge that those timeframes may be challenging to meet in the current circumstances.
The short answer is that we're passing the resolution today to enable consultation to pass the resolution in charter. The timeframe is based on what we currently know today. How that will change in the future, we don't know. Flexibility, yes, we do retain that. This is a small community of 97 people, so we're in constant contact with them.
The time frame that needs to be met is the 30th of June, the season of things for next year, is that the rough annual plan is, so I would like us to be flexible and allow that time to be given to the community as we are with our current annual plan. Councillor Hassan.
I just have a query over where it mentions clause 0 and clause 00. I just want to know are they actually number of clauses or should that actually have a relevant clause number there? Just conscious of understanding what 0 and 00.
So,
item number 7 is on pages 269 through 271. The council delegates the ability to approve a grant from the Community Road Safety Fund to the grid manager infrastructure.
So moved.
Moved Councillor Alexander. Seconded Councillor Hannes.
I do have a question.
Councillor Alexander.
With the adoption of these delegations, I presume then that in our transportation report where there were previous requests for funding from this fund, that those funds had not yet been granted because there was no delegation?
Sorry for those at home. We will follow up on the answer for that for Councillor Alexander. Any further discussion? All those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
Against? Declare carries. Item number 8 is on pages 272-308. It's a stock broker bylaw 2019 that we adopt the amended bylaw. Move Councillor Miller. Seconded Councillor Lehman. Is there any discussion on this? That's my mouth.
Sorry, I'm just turning the microphone on. Yeah. Just to provide a bit of context, obviously there was a hearing, myself and Councillor Lehman, attendance, three submitters, all of good quality, all raising genuine concerns about the workability of it. You'll notice some slight amendments just to take into account some of the issues there. Some of the issues that were raised fell outside the scope of the bylaw review, and we replied to those people that although their concerns were going to a better action under district plan review, and hopefully they're taking them on board. Generally good process, clear intention there around what has always been done traditionally and what the new health and safety regulations impose, but I think the realisation is that most of our health and safety plans should take into account strong program, so there's a crossover. Transition period should be relatively short once people are on board with health and safety regulations. So, thanks for Councillor Lehman for attending and helping, and particularly Mark Chamberlain for all the work on. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone further have anything that they would like to say? Councillor Hassan.
Just one issue, and it's one that always comes up, and I guess it is the enforcement issue. With regards to the stock broking bylaw, it's standard that after, you know, the road crosses, that there needs to be some maintenance, and if we don't get on top of it, sometimes it does have a habit of lapsing, with requirement to sweep the roads or to put carpet down or to manage road crossings so we don't get the build-up that can actually cause a problem to our roads, and I just want to highlight that, like any bylaw that we pass, there needs to be efficient monitoring in place to make sure that we don't see our standards.
That was specifically raised. Need my microphone to that. Apologies. Was specifically raised, and the traditional small aircraft we're talking about now. Largely being absorbed into larger scale dairy farms with underpasses, so the problems that were existing in the community before are not so large, but I agree that enforcement is part of the package. We discussed in great detail, myself and Councillor Lehman and the submitters, and we continue to believe that myself, and particularly around a range of bylaws, takes an educational approach first before waiting to speak. That has proven effective in the past and is continuing to prove effective. But at the end of the day, as you suggest, Councillor, the official point be with the force, but an educational approach is first ready for care for the rank. Thank you, Councillor Miller. Any further discussion? All those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
Against? Declare it carried. The next is the receiving of the Solid Waste Monthly Report. This will be a report that we. Sorry for those at home, that was passed. We're now moving on to the next item. The Solid Waste Monthly update will be coming to us on a regular basis. We would have had Andrew Boyd here to discuss things, but due to circumstances, we don't. So this is a report that's on the agenda. Public information
to issue it. It was just that we received the report today, so I'll move that we receive it. Seconder?
I'll second it.
Councillor Lyle? Is there any discussion on the report? All those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
Against? Declare it carried. And similarly with the transportation report that we received, the transportation monthly update, again, the report that we will get regularly. This is information for councillors and also information for our community. We would have had the transport staff here today, but we don't, so today is really just about receiving that report and sharing it with the public. Again, I hope that we receive it. Is there a seconder? Thank you, Councillor Alexander. All those in any discussion?
Just for the Chief Executive's information, page 324 is...
Microphone mark, sorry, Mr.
324? 324, page... For the Chief Executive's information, page 324 mentions the request for funding from the grant to which it didn't have delegations. So that was the question, the grants that I was questioning earlier, and now that the delegation is in place, if they are still getting funding, they presume they can be funded.
Just want to draw your attention to page 319, our outsteel roads assessment. We're actually climbing again, particularly in the light of proposed rate increases for our rural ratepayers. And we've done a lot of work, particularly with the Audit Risk Committee, about our standard and timeliness of maintenance. It appears that we're not holding our word, that we believe we could maintain a very efficient, well-maintained metal network. That more emphasis needs to be placed. If you're not going to get your road sealed, it needs to be maintained at a suitable level to not decline.
Thank you, Councillor Lever.
Thank you, Sam. It's really just a query to the Chief Executive, I guess, around a number of these projects. You're looking at page 317. There's some there that may, in light of COVID-19, not be able to continue, and it's about one in particular, but there'll be others that we communicate with those people and those affected parties as rapidly as possible once we know the ability to continue or not with those projects, because it does have ongoing effects in one case for private landowners, but for others just about surety around what projects will and won't continue. So I'm sure it's in hand, but I'm just making it more.
Yes, that is, and that was one of those things that we were talking about earlier on, because not only do we know what we want to do and how things might impact on our schedule, but equally we don't know what our contractors will be capable of doing, because of course they're following the same situation as we are in terms of staff exposure.
Any further discussion on this item? All those in favour that receive it, say aye.
Aye.
Against? Declare it carried. It's been voted on and carried. Sorry for those of you who haven't heard that. The next item is item number 11, property transaction update. Again, that will be received for information. We would have had Douglas Marshall, group manager, here today, but again, we weren't able to do that. So this is about sharing updates over the last month. Moved to Councillor Lyle, seconded to Councillor Gallagher. Any discussion? Oh, if you have discussion or you just wanted to second it. Okay. All those in favour, say aye.
Aye.
Against? Declare it carried. Item number 12 was going to be the District Health Board presenting to us. We've asked that David to present an update around COVID-19 to the group. And we also have one new paper that I should have mentioned at the beginning that was circulated to councillors yesterday. Which is around the delegations to the Executive Committee. The reasons for needing extra delegations is because of the uncertainty around being able to meet in person, and also uncertainty around the timing of any government changes to allow a meeting to occur if we're not in person. Delegations to the Executive Committee is about enabling Council to continue to do the work that we must do. It's not about excluding any one councillor from the process, because I would expect that you would all want to be a part of those meetings and can link into them online from your home. It's just that we can't have a meeting for you to join. If you don't have an executive meeting, we can't continue to call the council meetings. If legislation changes and we're able to continue to have council meetings, then there'll be no need for the executive meeting executive committee to meet, and we'll just deal with it as the full council. There's a recommendation in the paper that the executive gets scheduled meetings at least once a week. We have to give 24 hours notice of any executive meeting anyway, and allowing them to be scheduled in for once a week just allows that to occur without the notification process weekly, and if needed or required before that, then we will give full notice and share all agendas with councillors and provide the ability for councillors to be involved in those discussions, including speaking rights. There are some other delegations that will be brought back to the executive committee, and that's really around the continuing functioning of council. It includes the audit and risk, it includes delegations implemented to community committees who are also unable to meet at this time. My hope is that these could all transfer back as soon as possible, and the funding that was or is allocated to community committees isn't lost to them because they're unable to meet and spend it, but will be held over for them into the future. So this paper is really to help us navigate through the next few weeks of uncertainty until government changes the legislation of the council can continue to meet ourselves and other meetings can happen online.
Very minor things. Firstly, the paper has been peer reviewed by legal advisors earlier this morning. One minor amendment, it's recommendation of a financial delegation of $200,000 to the chief executive. Our legal people are suggesting to insert the words subject to the restrictions set out in clause 32(1)(c), which is the section of the Local Government Act, specifically that is around borrowing money. Borrow for less than that. Otherwise, it's just another typo further through track. This is something we've got in place in the unlikely event that we're going to use it. I'm very comfortable that we have got the processes set up. I think today's a good example of the way the meetings work. And I think the other thing that we all need to remind ourselves of are that Cabinet are currently looking at regulations that will allow councils to under lockdown circumstances, which would use certainly for this recommendation. Assurance is given that the administration for the committee will be provided by myself and my direct staff, both of them in the room at the moment. The agendas will be circulated well in time, and yes, once the lockdown is over, we will immediately pass a resolution referring back to the process.
The last thing to say is that there's been a lot of discussion from councils around the country on this. Christchurch passed similar rules yesterday, and other councils have been doing it this week to allow them to continue the function. A lot of them didn't have executive committees already set up in terms of reference, so they've ended up calling them emergency committees set up for this express purpose. If there's any questions, happy to take them back. Councillor Lindner.
Thank you, Sam. I guess for clarity, we should say who that executive committee is, and for those of you who are reporting from them. And as such, I don't think it should be moved by any members of those of that committee, so I will move that we adopt.
I'll second
them.
Thank you. Moved by Lemon and seconded
by Alexander. And for clarity, the members of the committee are the mayor, the deputy mayor, and another councillor, all their alternates, because any one of us could be taken down by COVID, and this is around providing flexibility for at least three of us to meet, with support from the chief executive, or staff, should they be taken up, so that council can continue. Thank you, Councillor Lemon and Alexander. Is there any further questions? Councillor Reid.
My question is around the same.
Yes. If you should undertake all funding or something that can't be given to those sectors. Funding that's given to those committees would continue to remain in place, albeit with the hiatus through this current emergency period.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Councillor
Miller. I just wonder whether the continuation of the delegation to the development committee would just not appropriate. It doesn't seem to make any sense to pull the delegation back through the other committees of the community board. And given how fast the pace of changes, it would make sense for those decisions to be brought back to council as well, I would say.
Yeah, no, two questions just raised by legal advice on this point to have this as well. The reason I left the Melbourne Community Board off is that effectively their meeting schedule, I think we've got one meeting later in this lockdown period, but in terms of the delegations that are given to them, none of those would be effective through that period of time. So it's just time to talk through that with the chair.
Just while we're all in the room, I think it's...
I'd like to fix it.
I think if you're going to do something, do it right to start with. I mean, you may have to come back and do it again, so why not when we're all here, bring it back to the executive committee and then re-delegate as appropriate. That would be my view, but I don't know what the wide group thinks.
Are there other views? Councillor Alexander.
Yeah. Following on from Councillor Reeve, I think one of the concerns is that sort of our township discretionary funds, the committees were about to make their final allocations of this year's funding. If they're unable to meet, they're unable to make those allocations. And the concern was the funds operate on a use or lose it basis. So if they're unable to meet this month, next month, and possibly longer, then are they at risk of losing this funding because it will simply not be rolled over? That's the assurance thing. But with respect to what Councillor Miller was saying, I agree with him. It's inconsistent to pull the ward discretionary funds for every other ward, for example, in under the executive committee, but leave the Malvern ward's delegation to the community board standard. The community board will not be able to meet any more than any other of our committees. So I would agree with Councillor Miller that if we're to be consistent and be practical, those should also be withdrawn as they are being withdrawn from any other committee in the district.
Basically, with respect to community committees, that will be written to a separate thing to advise the situation. Secondly, I can't think of any compelling reasons to disagree with Councillor Miller or Councillor Alexander. So I would suggest a recommendation age that we say Selwyn Central Discretionary Fund Springs meeting, including funding applications for the Melbourne Community Board. So replace all the excluding for the closing one. And it'll clear up.
Does anybody, just while we focus on the community board matter, does anybody disagree with what has been said around the burden in this, because I think that it makes sense that it would be all in one. One of the reasons why they weren't initially is because they're not a community of council, it's not one of our committees, but they are our delegations. So legally they stand on their own, but we have delegated the powers to them, it might be to them. So we're only removing the powers of delegation and the funding, and we're not actually controlling whether or not they meet. So if that's the view of the room, then we'll just insert that's in there, and that will be done. Councillor Lemon.
Yeah, thank you, Sam. It was a good suggestion by Councillor Miller, and as the mover of that, I'm happy for that amendment to be made.
Thank you. Councillor Alexander. Okay, everyone's happy with those amendments. All those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
Against, declare it carried. And I'll just ask David to update around COVID and staff.
Right, yeah, so, excuse me, some of the stuff I'm telling you you already know, but just to bring everybody up to speed, so we have established our pandemic response groups for the past week or so. Group A, which is currently functioning, is made up of Tony Harris, Sarah Shea, Stephen Hill, and myself.
myself, with any support being provided, and there's others coming in from time to time. That group will continue in operation through till 9 a.m. Monday, when the other four managers of the management team will take over those responsibilities, and we're exercising degrees of separation of the plans, just to make sure that we're not impacted, because in this case scenario, it would be that if one of us became affected, we're all affected, so we'll take over there. As of Tuesday, staff are generally working from home. Staff are working really under four groups. The first one is essential services, and I'll talk about those in just a moment. The second one is those who are able to provide business as usual from home. The third group is what we call affected staff, so it's the ones the Prime Minister identified over the weekend, the over 70s, the ones who have immune deficiencies, etc. And the fourth group is those who we would call available who deploy themselves to staff. They were generally operating out of facilities that have closed down or who provide function and who do functions within the organisation that we won't be providing at the moment. We have established extensive databases of all our staff, not only maintaining contact details, their whereabouts, but we are also in daily contact with staff. You have been receiving copies of the emails. You didn't get one yesterday. In fact, what we did yesterday, we did a video. I'll send you around a copy of the message that I sent out to staff last night. We have a skeleton staff working in customer services, and the skeleton staff working through the building. Personally, I will be working in the building Thursday, Friday of this week, and intermittently over the next few weeks during lockdown. We have defined what we call essential services, and I shall just read that list to you. This is external, and this is my girlfriend. Don't worry about writing it down, because I'm going to send you a copy of this email anyway for the public record. And in no particular order, animal control, building consents will continue the process to consent applications as they come in. Just on building inspections, we have been carrying out yesterday urgent inspections, although they will be withdrawn through the lockdown period. Provision of camping grounds, we have staff out there, and we have quite considerable numbers. We do daily counts, we are having daily liaison with people who are in those camping grounds, and again, I will send you the numbers of those people. Also cleaning our facilities on a more regular basis within the camping grounds. Cemeteries, noise control, public toilets, resource consents, we will continue to process applications as they come in. Roading, particularly critical and urgent roading repairs and maintenance. Rubbish and recycling collections will continue as normal, albeit the Pines Resource Recovery Park is closed to the public. Water and wastewater we are continuing to provide. As I say, that is an evolving list and certainly the direction coming out of it and flexibility. Interesting from the 2 nights ago, I think that the initial list came out of internal affairs. It was really interesting to see the pushback the other white numbers playing on that. Internally, we've added a few crucial services, paramount staff welfare, customer liaison, accounts payable, payroll, banking facilities, access to those, and the staff are able to provide all of those functions, either working here and or working from home. With respect to the staff that are on those facilities that have either closed down or provide functions that are not considered essential or crucial during the lockdown period, we have a range of things from maintenance, from cleaning, through provision of programs. I know that the local staff are doing story time online and development projects like that, including sanitising the box that are within our libraries. Obviously, we're in a lockdown period for 4 weeks. I'm meeting with other councils on a regular basis just to see what they're doing over that period of time and how they're responding to those services. So, as I say, daily communication
discussions with staff, and they include things like the over FAQs that hopefully you've all seen and got access to. An interesting one we got from EAP services the other day, which was circulated to us for parents and caregivers, because obviously going into lockdown, you know, and working from home in family situations, and also our internal people and capability support for our staff. So, Mr. Mayor, I'm totally confident that staff are responding in a manner that we should be very, very proud of, that we understand and are responding to essential services. Most importantly, that we have flexibility, and that's that flexibility to respond not only to those queries, the unforeseen queries, the emergency situations, you know, the pothole repair requests, all of those sorts of things. So, wait again.
Are there any questions of the CEO? I'll move that we receive the Council Credit 19 verbal update from our CEO, seconded Councillor Lennon. Any further discussion? All those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
Against? That brings us to the end of the open meeting. Someone would like to move to be adjourned to PX. End of the open meeting, and we'll move into PX. Speaker Councillor Lyle and Speaker Councillor Gallagher. All those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
Against, declare a carriage, and we'll just take a 5 minute break to allow a reshuffling of the people in the room. And goodbye to those that have joined us on.